and welcome to Reliving My Youth. My name is Noel Fogelman. Chances are you have heard my guest's voice, but just didn't know her name. Well, her name is Tessa Niles. She's one of the most accomplished background and session singers out there. She's worked with some amazing artists like Eric Clapton, David Bowie, Duran Duran, Tears for Fears, Robbie Williams, name a few. And this is the 35th anniversary of Live Aid. And she was part of David Bowie's band on that magical day. She tells a couple great stories. About 5 years ago, she wrote a book called Backtrack, which chronicles her career. It's a fantastic book. It's anywhere you can find it. I'd recommend the audio version because she has such a lovely voice. We did this interview a few months ago, so we talked about Rupert Hine before his passing, the legendary producer. Tessa's such a lovely lady. I could have talked with her for a couple more hours because we didn't get to half the artists she worked with. Hopefully someday I will. Hope you enjoy my conversation with her. What was like the inspiration for you like to write the book? And like, was that something that you thought about for a while before actually putting pen to paper?
Yeah, well, to be honest with you, it was the topic of conversation that came up most in my life, really. Right. Oh, you've worked with so many artists, you should write a book. And I was like, yeah. I'm not a writer, I'm a singer. Right. So I kind of, but it became that thing where if I went to a dinner party and, somebody found out what I did, I suddenly became the center of attention. Right. And in a way, that was very flattering and very nice. I didn't always like it because, you don't always want to talk about yourself. But but I realized that there was a genuine interest. And when I moved to South Africa in 2007, I wasn't working, really. I was bringing up the kids and supporting my husband's ventures. I decided it was a great time to look back. It was the perfect time, really, to kind of reassess, have a little look back. And also, I mean, essentially, I wrote it for my kids, not thinking that it would do anywhere near as well as it's done. So that was just a bonus. So that was really how it came about.
Right. Have your kids been like very interested in your career? Like, asking a lot of questions about certain artists and just about like your time in the business?
Yeah, there was a time when they were younger, sort of, I'd say from about 8 to about 14, where they were really nonplussed about the whole thing. It was like, yeah, it's mom's job, she works with rock stars, next, where's my video game? But as they got older, they got more and more interested. And in fact, my one daughter, who's downstairs, she's in the floor below me now, she's studying musical theatre.
Okay.
And so she's not exactly following in mom's footsteps. I mean, she's very accomplished. So she's, always had an interest, and there's always been music around. It's always been a shed load of music from me and my husband. So yeah, it was inevitable that one of them was gonna do it.
Even before you started with the idea of the book and people, sat down at dinner with you and talking about your career, what was like the one question you got the most?
Oh, without doubt, who was probably on equal footing, who was the nicest person you worked with and who was the worst?
Okay.
Classic kind of. And the thing is, it's so difficult to really, because one's career is kind of multifaceted and it's not just about liking someone or loving someone or not liking someone. It's very nuanced in that way.
Yeah, and like, cause you met, it's also a business association, so they're nice, they're mean. Doesn't matter, you're there to do a job. Yeah, so
thank you. Right. You get it.
Right. Yeah, because in the book Backtrack, which everyone check out, it's on Amazon, Kindle, Audible, it's everywhere. You really didn't it wasn't like a tell all, kind to like out people. It was just your experiences working with certain people. And it was really a good listen. And I said before the interview, you really should have a career in recording audiobooks. It's fantastic.
That's very kind of you.
Sure, but going way back, was there one particular moment you realized that this was something you wanted to do in your life?
Well, session singing was never really the thing. I didn't even know it existed when I was growing up. I mean, I used to avidly look at the back of people's albums, and like we all did, you know, so-and-so played on that, and then you'd see that they played on something else. And so I loved that whole thing about seeing, which artists had played and played the supporting role. But as for becoming a session singer, no, I just wanted to sing. I just wanted to be a singer. I had no idea where it was going to take me. And in those days, listeners might find this a little hard if they're below a certain age. There was no internet.
Right.
There was no Google. How do I become a singer? You just kind of found your way. It's extraordinary, really, that we all did. We survived without the internet. And I think I was always interested in music. My brother and I sang a lot of harmonies together, which I mentioned quite a bit early on in the book, and loved it. And he had a great school friend who had a small recording studio, very sort of basic recording studio. But the minute I got in there and started to sing and layer up harmonies and hear how my voice could sound multi-tracked, I was kind of in love. That was it. I didn't really analyze it. I didn't really know why I was in love with it, but I loved because it felt to me as if I could potentially recreate some of the sounds of my favorite artists, you know, possibly, you know, layer up vocals like the Carpenters or like Stevie Wonder. And it just opened up a whole world to me. And then, of course, at that point, schoolwork became seer, you know. I was only interested in singing, didn't know how to get into it, but music became my everything. And left school very young, really, left school at 16, much to my parents' dismay in a way, but they were still very supportive. But, you know, they were worried because I wouldn't have had anything to fall back on. And that was it, really. I began the journey of attempting to get into the music industry.
How difficult was that, like, attempt to actually break through in the business?
You know, it just seems, now I look back at it, maybe I'm looking back a little bit with rose-colored glasses, but it did seem quite organic at the time. You know, I met people, I was introduced to people who knew people, who introduced me to other people. It just seemed to be very word of mouth. I started off singing in cabaret groups. So kind of working in hotels and clubs and bars, like so many of us started out doing. And then I had a very auspicious meeting with my now ex-husband, a gentleman called Richard Niles, who was very much on the ladder of success with his career. And so he helped me enormously, just introduced me to the right people, booked me on a few things. But of course, I had to prove myself over and above being producer or the arranger's girlfriend.
Right.
Because, you know, that wasn't going to last. So I had to do a good job. And I realized then that session singing, I was good at it. You know, I could do it. I could layer up vocals. I could work with very little instruction. You know, it's like, can you put a chorus on this for us? And I was like, yeah, okay. You know, and so I could do that. But I was still, at the same time, I was still going for a solo career because I thought that's kind of what you did.
Right.
So I did that for a while, had a few attempts, but it didn't really happen for whatever reason. And looking back on it now, I think I perhaps didn't have that singular drive that you need to be an artist or need to be, you know, successful in any career. You need to have that absolute singular drive that kind of push everybody else out of the way almost and do that. So when that wasn't transpiring, when it wasn't really happening, the solo career, I was in tandem getting more and more session work. And I just thought, you know what? I'm a team player. This is what I do best. And so that work started to take over and I started to build and make a name for myself.
Right. And one of the names in the book that you mentioned a lot that had kind of a big influence in your career was producer Trevor Horn. And everyone from the 80s knows Trevor Horn, you know, worked and produced so many different artists, you know. What was like the experience working with him? And have you worked with him, you know, in the past like 15, 20 years or anything like that?
Yeah. My first introduction to Trevor was, I, think I'd heard of him before, but I didn't really know him. And in about 82, I had a call from an engineer saying, can you get down to the studio? And I showed up and there were these four kind of gangly, weird-looking guys from Sheffield, which is in the Midlands, in like the steel area of the UK. And I was introduced to Trevor Horn, who was producing these four guys. And these four guys turned out to be ABC. And so that was my first big break, if you like. It was the first time I'd ever worked for a really big producer. Although, to be fair, I think Trevor's career was still, he was known for the Buggles.
Right.
But he hadn't really made his mark as a producer yet. And I think that ABC album kind of cemented that for him. So for all of us working on that particular project, it became a game changer. We all did really, really well on it, and it was number one across the world. So thanks, Trevor. Yeah, and in the most recently, I worked on an artist called Robbie Williams, who's not hugely well known in the US,
right?
But he's massive in other parts of the world, in Europe and Australia and South America. He's huge. So yeah, I did some work with Trevor on that.
Right. Now, you brought up Robbie, who you worked with for you know, a while, and seemed like a great guy in the book and everything like that.
I love the fun.
Yeah, the ice skating story I really enjoyed in the book. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, but why do you think, like, because, you know, he had a nice career, and he's still going, you know, in the States, but not as massive, you said, in Europe. Why do you think that was the case?
It's really interesting, Noel. I've thought about that many times because actually I did go to the States with Robbie,
right,
and as part of the band to try and break America. I think largely they didn't really get him. He didn't have a massive following to begin with because over here he'd been in a band called Take That.
Right.
Since I think he was 16 years old or something. So we on this side of the pond had had this massive history with Robbie coming up through this boy band thing, a little bit like a Justin Timberlake kind of situation.
Of course.
And then when he emerged as a solo artist, we all had this kind of great fondness and history for him, whereas the US didn't, perhaps. And maybe that's why he didn't take.
Yeah, no, that's a great point, because we had our own, like you mentioned, Justin Timberlake, we had our own boy bands here, so I guess, you know, I guess they're oversaturated with boy bands, so I guess, you know, why have another, you know,
Exactly. And he's really quirky too, Robbie. He's very kind of, he can be irreverent, he can be a little risque, he can be a little bit bonkers, and I'm not sure that, you know, if you hadn't had that history with him before, that it was going to kind of go over.
Right. And you mentioned, you know, ABC and the Lexicon of Love album, which was fantastic. And there were kind of four gangly guys. And as I guess the 80s moved on, you would think of Martin Fry, lead singer of ABC, really cool, the cool suits and everything like that. Did you see kind of that transformation, like, in him?
Yeah, very much so. I mean, I always remember Trevor talking about Martin Fry as one of the greatest lyricists he'd ever heard in pop, because he wasn't strictly writing about love all the time, and he was very poetic, and of course those lyrics and that music coupled with Trevor's use of strings, orchestras, you know, was quite radical, hadn't really been done before, so it just hit at that right time.
Yeah, right. And that song, the off of Place Kind of Love, Dates Them, great song. Looking for the girl that meets supply.
Promise that it doesn't.
Then you ended up working with them later on I forgot the name of the album, with the single When Smokey Sings, which, great song. My mother's favorite artist is Smokey Robinson. But they didn't include you in the video, though. I guess that was kind of an issue for certain, like, background singers back then?
Yeah, it was, and it became more and more so because it was about the lessening of the control of the unions here. At the same time, it was kind of a lot of unions were losing power here, and the musicians' union just couldn't fight it. So what was happening? And I mean, some say, look, the artists should be able to use whoever they want, right, visually.
Yeah.
And I think now I kind of agree with that. At the time, I think we were all very miffed that this was a loss of income, yeah, and why weren't they using us? You know, because we had other people miming. It meant that other people were miming to our voices, which we thought was kind of unfair.
Right.
So they were getting the kudos for my work, if you like. And so it definitely rubbed the wrong way. I did try and fight it. But by that time, the unions just kind of didn't have enough power. So, it went by the by. And now it's pretty much the norm.
Right. Yeah. And because, you know, back then, obviously, videos are more prevalent than they are now, you know, MTV and VH1 over here. But was that the band's choice? Was that the record label's choice? The record? Whose ultimate decision was that?
I'm pretty sure it was the band's.
Okay.
Yeah. They would have possibly preferred a certain look. You know, they wanted a certain image. They probably wanted to use models. And, right, you know.
Yeah.
It was really a kind of an artistic direction they were going in. It just so happened that it kind of meant that, you know, we had to shout a bit louder, excuse me, that's me.
What, yeah. I guess that would make, you know, sense and say like a Robert Palmer video where the model's in the background not really doing anything, but like, you know, you're performing, you know, vocals and, you know, it kind of takes a little bit away from the song, I think.
It does. Did you think at the time, though, that people thought that they'd sung on that? Do you think people got the fact that it was just done for visual purposes?
I would probably say it was probably split. Mm. I would think that, you know, if they mimed it, you know, pretty well, they would think that it was them doing it, you know.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
otherwise, you know, people like, I know who sings this. I'm a fan of the band, so I would know. But, you know, it's probably, I would say, split down the middle.
Yeah, absolutely. It was a strange time, but there was so much work going on. You almost didn't have time to think about it too much because, right, there was just so much going on, you know.
Yeah.
And I get it now. I do get it. I do understand. I still feel for the artists who are not credited, you know.
No, of course.
Which still happens, unfortunately, today.
Yeah. And you mentioned, like, just now, you had so much, you know, work, you know, during that time. Was there ever an artist that you had to turn down because you had so much work?
Oh, that's a really good question. Yes, I think there were quite a few. I'm trying to think. I don't think anybody major. I managed to kind of work it, yeah, thankfully, that I my work was sort of split between doing touring work, so going on tour with bands, and then coming back and doing sessions and jingles. So I used to do quite a lot of jingles as well. So it was kind of 50-50 at one point until I really started working with Clapton, and then the touring became pretty much kind of most of the year.
Yeah, we'll get to Eric in a little bit. But then you worked with probably the biggest bands during that time, The Police. Also, another one of my favorites in the story in the book was, yeah.
We're not worthy.
Yeah. It's, luckily, they reunited about 15 years ago. I was able to see that tour.
Did you see that?
I saw that one.
Oh,
it was, thankfully, I saw it in Madison Square Garden. So at least it was a few shows after it started, because I guess it was kind of a rough start for them.
Sure.
Yeah. I think they were still on speaking terms at that point, but
but only just, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, but like, what was like that experience? You mentioned in the book about meeting Sting for the first time, and, you know, Andy and Bernard. So, what was that story like? Or Stuart, I should say, that experience like?
It was bonkers, really. I mean, it was nuts in that I was this kid who was really actually, I was kind of the same age that my daughters are now. So to about, around about 22, I just started working with a jazz funk band who were very well known here called Morrissey Mullen, which were two guys, Dick Morrissey and Jim Mullen. And I was ecstatic. We were doing pub gigs and, you know, to 150 people three times a week. And I was coining it in. You know, I just thought I was doing so well, didn't need to go to the bank anymore. I was just making cash from all of these gigs and I was riding high. I thought life was extremely good. And I was kind of learning on the job and especially learning how to sing live because I'd done a bit of studio work before that, but this was really a live thing. And then I got a call one day from a lady called Marsha Hunt. And Marsha, for anybody that remembers, was the poster girl for Hair, the musical in the 1960s. They used her big afro and she was also had a relationship with Mick Jagger and they had a child together. And she knew my then husband at the time, Richard Niles. So she called Richard and said, do you think Tessa can get down to a rehearsal studio like by 4 o'clock this afternoon? And of course my husband said, well, yeah, absolutely. So I had no idea who I was going down to meet, but this was quite a big thing. And obviously coming from Marsha, it was obviously quite legit. And so I went down and as I stood outside the main studio door, which was kind of sealed, as you can imagine, those kind of rehearsal studios are pretty well kind of like steel doors and lots of soundproofing. I heard this kind of jangling of these final chords of a song. There was nobody there to meet me. So I was just kind of standing there thinking, oh, my God, what do I do? Yeah. And I pulled open the door and it was like the last chord of Roxanne or something like that. And I just saw Sting, Stuart and Andy in the room and I went, you know, I nearly fainted. I was like, OK, girl, breathe, you know, keep it together. Hold it together, love. Yeah. And there they were, you know. Right. And then I had to speak to them.
Yeah.
And not make a complete fool of myself.
Right.
Anyway, it turned out that the tour was going to happen in about a week's time. And Sting was worried about his voice. He was worried about losing his voice on tour because it was a really big tour. It was the Synchronicity tour. And at the time, I had no idea it was going to be their last tour.
Right.
But they were riding high. They were number one in the charts with Every Breath You Take. And this was going to be a massive tour. And so I sort of introduced myself to the three of them. Very uncomfortably. I was, you know, really awkward thing. There was no one there to introduce me. And I kind of just had to introduce myself. And then from that, Sting said, well, look, can you come to my house and just have a little bit of a sing? I think, I don't know whether it was like tomorrow or the next day or whatever. And I was like, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So that's what happened. So then I went up to Sting's house. And there was a little story attached to him playing Every Breath for me on the piano. And the two other singers that were there also. Shall I tell that story? Well, yeah. So we were standing around the piano in Sting's very lovely home in North London. And so this was really an audition. I mean, it wasn't called an audition, but to all intents and purposes, it was an audition.
Right.
So at some point, Sting was kind of playing Every Breath and we were working out the vocals and singing along. And then at some point, for some reason, I decided I needed to chirp in with a comment. Mm-hmm. And I said, oh, love this. It's so great. You know, it just reminds me of that kind of country music kind of voicing thing going on in the background. And Sting just stopped playing. And there was like dead silence. And I thought, I better get my coat. You know, this is like, I've really said the wrong thing. He really doesn't like what I've said. He doesn't like the reference to country music. And I just, my poor colleagues, you know, who were standing there with me probably wished they'd been underneath the piano at this point. And then the silence broke and Sting just threw back his head and just howled of laughter. And he said, oh, don't mind me, pet. He said, come on, pack your bags. We're going on tour. Yeah. So I was like, oh, my God. And that was it. And then 5 days later, we were on tour. And it was my first tour. So it was Baptism by Fire.
Wow. Were you? Was that your first trip to America as well?
No, I'd actually been to America a few times. Well, my first husband was American.
Okay.
And I had also been on holiday to the States as a kid. Oh. We had a big family holiday when I was about 12, and we went to California. So, yeah, so I'd been a couple of times. Been a few times, yeah. But this, nothing like this. This was like...
Yeah.
Ooh.
Right. But it was. It seemed like it was difficult, right, performing all the songs because he wanted it a certain way. And...
Yeah. Sting sings in a particular way. He doesn't use a lot of vibrato when he sings. And if you think about songs like Roxanne, you don't have to put on the red light. It was all very much at the top of his register, full tilt. There was no sort of softness there. It was all very, very strong singing, which was probably one of the reasons he wanted some backup singers so that he didn't have to push quite as hard as he normally did, or that he could potentially lay back sometimes. So apart from the fact that we had to learn almost the entire Police catalogue in about 5 days, which was not easy, because we didn't know what songs they were actually going to choose until we arrived in the States and started to rehearse properly. So, yeah, we had to learn a ton of songs. And then we had to sing without vibrato, which is definitely a difficult skill. I wouldn't recommend it. The singers use vibrato very often to keep their voices soft and flexible, and it helps them not strain. So our directive from Sting was no vibrato and sing kind of like Sting.
Wow. Was that the first time you had to perform without vibrato?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay. I've never heard of it before. I've done it since. A lot of artists actually either don't like it or they don't use it themselves. So, yeah, I've done it many times, but that was the first. And live, it's particularly difficult because you're singing so hard. At least in the studio, you can take a break between songs.
Yeah. Otherwise, you have like 10 seconds between songs, yeah. What was the most difficult song to perform on the tour?
I think actually Synchronicity was quite hard to sing live. Mm-hmm. There's a video of it. If you go onto YouTube, there's a video of the Synchronicity tour.
Right.
And yeah, that one, because it was the opening song as well, so there was no nice lead into it. It was like, boom.
Yeah.
So that was...
Right. On that tour, did they kind of keep the set list the same to make it, or did they change it up for a show?
No, it was pretty much the same. I mean, occasionally they would add things.
Right.
And occasionally we'd all whine and moan about, oh, why don't you do da-da-da-da?
Right.
Oh, hate that song, not doing it. There were certain songs he didn't want to do, but yeah. Largely it was the same set, yeah.
Okay, all right. So, yeah, keep you on your toes. So at least it was good that, you know, it was the same, right?
Yeah. Thank goodness.
Yeah, exactly. But then, a massive artist that actually had a, I guess, his comeback was Tina Turner. The Private Dancer album, and you performed backup on one of her biggest songs, What's Love Got to Do With It? Yeah.
How? I still have to pinch myself.
Right.
Honestly, Noel, I still pinch myself. If I'm shopping in the supermarket or, you know, in the car and it comes on, I'm like, oh my goodness. Mm-hmm. And I didn't do a lot of singing on it. It's not one of those tracks that's got kind of wall-to-wall chorus vocals, like big massive thing. It's quite subtle. It just kind of sits underneath Tina's voice there. But wow, I'm so grateful and so extraordinarily fortunate to have, you know, performed on that track and others of Tina's.
Was she in the studio with you guys, or did you just kind of lay down those tracks without her?
No, she wasn't there. I met her when we were recording Simply the Best.
Okay.
And she was like this, like this energy field. She just, you know, she was explosive, just as you would imagine her to be. Just had this incredible energy. So that was the only time I met her, because very often, I know that, you know, Noel, and your listeners probably know as well, the tracks are put together separately. And if you like, the musicians come in and they do their sometimes things are recorded live, but very often it's the guitar player will go in and he'll play his parts down, or they'll do the rhythm section first and then they'll get into overdubs. So I was always, there was one producer called Chris Kimsey who produced the Stones, who used to say that when I came in, he was very sweet, he'd say it was like sprinkling fairy dust on the track, because they'd be living with all the, you know, these tracks for weeks and weeks, if not months. And then the female singers would come in and just kind of sprinkle their little harmony magic on the track.
Yeah. But
What's Love Got to Do With It? Tina wasn't there.
Oh, okay.
The minute I heard it, I just, was just undeniable, this hypnotic kind of groove thing going on. And then when the vocals were pulled up, I was like, well, if this isn't a hit, I'll eat my hat.
Right. Oh, and it was. So you didn't have to eat there. That was a good one. Grace Jones, Slave to the Rhythm, it's a great album and performed, background on that one as well. Did you meet her? Or is that also a similar situation?
Yeah. Didn't meet Grace. No, it's kind of weird now I think about it. You know, our lives are so interlinked, and yet we haven't met. So it's a bit strange in that way. But I was just listening to Slave to the Rhythm. Again, similar kind of thing. I'm certainly not all over it.
Yeah.
But it's interesting how producers, they really choose. You might do a ton of vocals when you're actually recording.
Right.
They might listen to it in the mix and just handpick a few spots, and that's the magic that they create, is knowing where to use it and where not to.
Right. Exactly. Were there any particular producers that you didn't like working with before, I should say?
There was one time, and it would be wrong of me to mention any names, but there was one time where I didn't quite get what the producer was doing. He was just so leaving it to me to come up with everything. And it often worked like that. There were kind of two different types of producers, some that knew exactly what they wanted, so they would give you full instruction and you just carried that out with very little kind of creativity on your part. And I was more than happy to do that because the producer knew what he wanted. So, I was fine with that, absolutely fine with that. But then you'd work with the producers who kind of were expecting you to come up
to do that work.
Yeah. Sometimes that meant almost that you were writing aspects of it. Mm. Not that you got co-writer's credit, but that's the nature of it. And and I was okay with that.
Okay. Well, one of the biggest concerts still to date is Live Aid. And just probably more in the limelight now with the Bohemian Rhapsody movie with Queen. Freddie Mercury, that was the best part of that movie, the last 20 minutes. And you worked with David Bowie, who obviously is one of the best artists of all time, and you were kind of contributed to the set list. You suggested he play Rebel Rebel. Was that your favorite song?
It was my absolute favorite period of his music. And I guess I must have been at school, and my maiden name is Webb. And so at school, I was, the kids would call me Webble Webble. So I don't know, it was a particular favorite. Yeah. It was so funny because Bowie said to us in rehearsals, what do you think? What do you think I should do? Like, you're asking us? Okay. Yeah. And so I immediately threw in Rebel Rebel, and I probably threw in something else. But yeah, I like to think that I was responsible for him doing it.
Right.
Yeah. He's probably going to do it. Yeah, right.
Like, when you're on the stage and look out at Wembley Stadium and you see the sea of people, probably 70, 80,000, was that just like a surreal moment for you guys?
Totally surreal, Noel. I don't even really know how to fully describe it, only that when I saw Bohemian Rhapsody, that opening section of the movie where the curtains, you're kind of backstage with Queen and the curtains open and they walk out and you can see the whole of the Wembley Stadium crowd in front of you. When I saw that, it was such a flashback for me. I was like, oh my word. This was my view. This is what I saw. And I was 22 years old. It was nuts. It was absolutely bonkers to walk out and experience that. And really, none of us knew what a pivotal moment that was in music history and our own history, because Live Aid was watched by a third of humanity. Yeah. But who knew?
Right.
Did you watch it?
I did, yeah.
You're a little young.
I was 10, but I watched it, yeah.
I was going to say, but do you have a memory of actually watching it?
I do, and I also bought, it's hard to find now, the box set of the whole concert. I still have that, and it was just great because I remember Phil Collins, who was one of my favorites back then, flying from London to go to Philadelphia to perform, and like Howard Jones performed as well. But just obviously Queen and David Bowie, it was just like, but how much of the show, I know because you were preparing for your set, were you able to kind of like geek and listen to?
Quite a bit, because we were there most of the day. And so it was heaven, you know. We were hobnobbing with all the stars backstage. But even though we were all there for a united cause, nobody knew the impact that it would have. Yeah. We really didn't, you know. And now, you know, it's gone down in history, I think, is probably one of the greatest concerts of all time. How it came together was a miracle. So Bob Geldof and Harvey Goldsmith, you know, were literal miracle workers. And I think it defined that period of time of music as well, because those great artists all performed. You know, you had the Stones and you had Clapton. I didn't even know Clapton at that time.
Right. Yeah. And how much did it, like, you know, help your career? Because, you know, you're right to, like, I guess the left of, you know, David Bowie during the whole set. So, like, how much of it did it help your career?
Oh, I think it turned things from, I mean, I already had some success.
Right.
But I think with that as a showcase, and the wonderful thing about Bowie was that he wanted to feature his band. He was generous. He was not intimidated by anybody else. He was such a massive star himself that we all felt as a band that he just wanted to bring us with him. So, you know, there are bands that you work for that don't want to feature the side musicians that much. I mean, we've all seen bands where, you know, the singers are right up at the back with barely the light on them. couldn't have been more different with Bowie. He wanted that close quarters. He wanted to feature everybody, and he was just remarkably generous. He wanted to know what we were wearing, which was very unusual, because most rock stars are, you know, wear a little black dress, you know, that was about the extent of it. So it was wonderful on all counts. Right. And I think my stock went up hugely after that, despite the fact that he got my name wrong.
Hello, vocals, Helena and Teresa Swift.
Yes, he did. Teresa, right?
Teresa.
Yeah. Teresa.
The other lady I was singing with was a lady called Helena Springs.
Yeah.
And when it came to the introductions at the end, which is after, was it after Heroes? Yeah. I think he introduces. Yeah. So if you go on to YouTube and check it out, he actually introduces me as Teresa Springs.
Yeah.
Yeah. Considered changing my name after that.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, who's this Teresa Springs? I want her on my album, you know?
Exactly. But no, he was, oh, bless him, he was nervous.
Of course. I mean, you know, 70,000 people in front of him and a billion of people watching, and of course.
Right? Yeah. Did he even remember people's names? I mean.
Yeah. But,
Slack.
Yeah. Another, like, tremendous artist who I think should be in the Hall of Fame are Duran Duran. Yeah. And it's a shame that they're not. And you worked, you know, a bunch of albums with them. And the first one was Notorious, right? Yeah. Were they like an artist that maybe because, you know, they were back so big in the early 80s, you know, MTV helped their career. Was that an artist that you, band that you were kind of like, you know, in awe of?
Or no? Oh, very much so. I loved the way, even though I didn't work with them when at the beginning of their careers, I mean, who didn't love, in fact, we were my daughters and I were just jamming to Rio the other day. And I was trying to tell, they'd never seen the video. And I said, oh my God, you have to go and see the video because that's like a seminal piece of work, you know, that defined, you know, the MTV VH1 era almost, that kind of very extravagant video. But I loved them. I loved them. I loved working with them in the studio. It was just an amazing band. And they have sustained, you know, a career. At one time, you know, I think people, it was considered to be a little bit uncool to be a huge fan of Duran, but they have just stuck with it. They have stayed. They've had different incarnations, as you know. They've kind of split off and done different things. But as a band, yeah, and they're still going and still sounding incredible. They're amazing.
Because Notorious was really good, and after that they kind of, like you mentioned, they had kind of a downturn until the Wedding album, which I think blew everyone's mind. Different sound, you know, Ordinary World, and you were featured on Come Undone, and you got your, you know, you're doing the video.
Well, no, I wasn't in the video.
That wasn't you in the water?
Shame. I know. I would have loved to have been that mermaid. What I wouldn't have given.
Oh, I'm sorry.
To be that mermaid. So, but she wasn't my, I don't, she was singing in the video. I don't know. I have to go back and check that. But I, yeah, she was gorgeous. She was a mermaid. Oh. So that was sadly another time where I didn't get to splash
her. I apologize.
No, it's quite all right. But that has been, I think it was top 10, the record in the States.
Yeah.
And that's been a great one for me. Lots of people have been very kind and said, you know, very nice things about my performance on that. And it was great to have a little step out role, if you like.
To
and it's quite featured in that particular song, so I was very lucky, very, very lucky. And I love hearing it to this day.
It's one of my favorite songs. And it's, there's a bunch of videos of it on YouTube, performance in there. It's great, yeah.
Yeah, but, thank you. I also loved Ordinary World. I didn't sing on it, but I just thought that was a magnificent single, and it really kind of brought them back.
It did, yeah. Did you tour with them too, right?
I did. We did some crazy gigs. I remember we opened the Hard Rock Hotel.
Okay.
In Vegas.
Oh yeah, that was.
I mean, they really are the ultimate party band.
Right.
So they were just so much fun. Too much fun, actually.
Right.
Yeah. Way too much fun. They were. Party Central. I had a ball with them. It was great.
No, that's great. Yeah. But, you know, some of the stories obviously are featured in Backtrack. So I don't want to, you know, I want people to read the books. I don't want to have to go through every story here.
Thank you. Oh, no, thank you.
Yeah. But my all-time favorite band is Tears for Fears. And they're like a kind of a mysterious band. You know, they're not the traditional band where they have to put up album after album. You know, I don't really have, you can't really put them in like a class, I don't feel. They weren't really a synth pop band, you know. But you worked on probably one of the most toughest albums for them, Seeds of Love, following, you know, Songs of the Big Chair, and was their last album for quite some time together. Did you kind of sense a strain between Roland and Kurt during that time?
I knew there was a strain between them because largely the work that I did on the album was with Roland.
Right.
So Kurt wasn't really around that much. And I knew, that the times were not easy for them. But again, you know, they've managed to ride that storm.
Yeah.
Like so many bands have, they're kind of better off together than apart.
Yeah.
I understand the notion of wanting to do things separately. And, you know, you almost grow up with these people and, you know, you think, well, What is it going to be like kind of doing some solo stuff? And then you realize, maybe not as good as when we're together. But I adored working for them, absolutely adored it. And I recently had spent some time with Chris Hughes, who produced the album. And he was telling me some lovely stories attached to it. But it was risky for them too, because they brought in Aleta Adams, which was a genius.
It was, yeah.
Who knew that? I mean, that story about Aleta being a singer in a nightclub and then absolutely falling in love with her when they were just on tour and they saw her performing in a bar.
Right.
And they said to her, next time we go on tour, you're coming with. And she was like, yeah, right.
Yeah,
sure. Sure, that's going to happen. You know, and then like 2 or 3 years later, they took her on tour. And so the album was really, it's so interesting how they developed and evolved from that kind of 80s electronica sound, which I was never a huge fan of, I've got to be honest. Those really, really early ones that they had didn't really kind of do it for me. But then when they started to think, you know, had things like Everybody Wants to Rule the World and Mad World, I was like, oh, okay, all right, these guys are serious. And then as soon as I began working with them, they're extraordinary.
Because you're featured on Year of the Night. We'll be right back.
Yes.
Yeah. Which
is yes.
A great song, and yeah.
Then the favorite track of mine on there is a track called Swords and Knives.
Swords and Knives, yeah.
Which is also very kind of strange, yeah. Experimental, but beautiful. I love it.
Yeah. And Phil Collins was also on Woman in Chains. That was featured Olita heavily in that song, which is fantastic.
Oh,
yeah.
That song.
That's great.
So I have a Facebook page and I posted that video the other day and I just kept watching it. I just couldn't believe how so powerful. I'm surprised, you know, some of these women's groups haven't picked it up and used it as an anthem because it's so anthemic.
Yeah. I remember the first time I saw them was in New York, and the concert opens with just a piano on stage, and Olita came out and she sang their song, I Believe. And it was like, whoa, she was like unbelievable and just like, amazing, you know. That's... you worked with her too a little bit.
I did, and I love that album so much. I mean, I still think to this day it probably hasn't had the success that really it warranted, because it's just a beautiful piece of work. And I think the cleverness of it lay with Olita, essentially a gospel American artist, and then Roland, this Brit kind of hybrid, you know, coming in and producing her, was a stroke of genius, because it took Olita down a path that was very different. You know, it wasn't the typical kind of black gospel route that she would perhaps have gone down with an American artist, a producer.
Yeah, because it was a Rhythm of Life, I think, the song they produced. Mm. Yeah, it was so good. Yeah.
So
I had her on my show a couple of years ago, and she was...
She's severe, isn't she?
Yeah, I was so happy, but she was great. Did you tour with them too a little bit, or no? Or you just worked on the album?
I never did, and it's funny, that actually goes back to the question. I think I couldn't tour with Tears for Fears because I was committed probably with Clapton at the time. But I would have loved to have gone on tour with them.
Right, yeah. And you mentioned, Eric, what was, like, how did that come about, and, like, your first experience meeting him?
I met him, I was introduced to him by my longtime singing partner, a lady called Katie Kasum. And she had done a tour with Eric and Roger Waters from Pink Floyd.
Right.
And so she knew Eric. And Eric called her up and said, look, we're doing some recording, Phil Collins producing. Do you know any other singers? And thankfully, she picked me. So eternally grateful to Katie Kasum for passing that on. And that was really a very important relationship. So met Eric, got on great, worked on the album. I think the album was August. I think it was called August. And then got a call sort of a couple of months later after release saying... actually, we did a TV show here that was very famous for years, decades here, called Top of the Pops.
Right.
God, that really ages it, doesn't it, calling it Top of the Pops. Well, so we did a Top of the Pops performance, and then it was like, okay, do you fancy going on the road? We're going to tour this beast of an album. And that was the start of a very long, fruitful, wonderful relationship with Clapton.
Right. When you were on Top of the Pops, did you have to do lip sync, or were you actually singing on that?
Yeah, we were lip syncing. Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah, and Top of the Pops was all about lip syncing.
Right, yeah.
Very few artists ever performed live.
Yeah, right. And then I know this is going to be a difficult, but when you guys are touring in the States, unfortunately, the tragic passing of Stevie Ray Vaughan, that was rough. I remember that day. And he was a fantastic artist, too. That had to be difficult to continue that tour.
Really hard. And I, if I'm very honest, I didn't think that it was a good idea to carry on touring. I think we were all so grief-stricken, because not only did we lose Stevie, but we also lost two members of our entourage. Eric's bodyguard, Nigel Green, and Colin, who was part of the kind of backstage crew. He was very much a kind of he was always around. He was very, very present. And so we were grieving. It was awful. But then it did come to the point, well, if Eric wants to continue, you know, we're his band. He's not going to do it without us. And it was the right thing to do, because I think music is such a healing process. And Eric has used, you know, music many, many times in his life to heal from various things that he's been through, and he has been through an awful lot. So it was the right thing to do, to carry on, working, as hard as it was really hard.
Yeah. Right. And I know this is a weird kind of thing to say, but like his healing, his turmoil kind of brought out joy in people listening to his music. You know, Tears in Heaven, it was, you know, I mean, unbelievable song.
He's one of the most relatable artists, I think, because Eric really does some of his best work when he's processing pain, and you know, a lot of artists are the same. I know that they use their difficult experiences to, you know, to fuel their music and their inspiration. And in that case, wow, yes, I remember the first time I heard Tears in Heaven, and you know.
Yeah. What was the last year that you toured with them?
I'm trying to think now. My daughters were born in 1998. So I think possibly around, like 1990, 2000, perhaps.
Okay.
Was about the last time.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Has he asked you since or no?
He hasn't, no. In fact, it's interesting because I also think that things have their time. Everything has their time. And I would love to be asked, I guess, but I also think it probably wouldn't happen. I don't know. I just think sometimes, as I say, things happen at the time. They have their own time, their own life. Having said that, though, my lovely friend Katie Kassoon recently has been back on the road with him because he had two singers after Katie and I, Shah and Michelle. And Michelle left to pursue a solo career, and Katie jumped in Michelle's spot. So it's now Shah and Katie doing the show. Right. And I'm sure she's absolutely amazing. I'm sure the fans are thrilled that she's back.
It's also being at the right place at the right time. It's all about opportunity.
Very true. Very true. And to be honest, I think in a way, I'm doing other things now.
Right.
So for instance, I'm broadcasting a lot more. I do a radio spot. I wrote a book. And so in a way, my career has, changed direction.
Yeah.
Shall we say. Yeah. So I don't know how I'd feel about sort of packing my bag and going on the road now at the grand age that I am. I kind of like being at home. Not in this situation, but
No, of course. Yeah. you mentioned that was kind of like a sticking point in your life, touring, affecting your personal life. But I'll leave that to the book, because everyone read the book. A couple of artists at Skate Club, and I had Trevor Steele on, and you did Wild Wild West. She's so mean, I don't care. Which I find that fascinating because they hit number one in the States, but they never charted in England with that song, which I never understood that.
I don't know if you ask people in the UK who the Escape Club are that they would really know.
Right.
Because as you say, for the reason they didn't have a number one hit. It's interesting, isn't it? Sometimes bands can have massive success in the US and not here, and but, you know, vice versa. I mean, remember Bush, that band Bush?
Yes.
Nobody knew who they were here.
Okay.
And they were a British band, I think.
They were huge here, yeah, for a couple of years. Yeah.
So it's funny how what takes sometimes in certain territories doesn't take in others.
Yeah, because that song was great here. I really, really enjoyed that. I had Trevor on also a couple years ago, and I think he's in California now, but yeah, I think he's he kind of, I don't know if he's just Escape Club by itself now, but he's kind of doing those 80s tours now. So
yes, as is another band with a guy that I know, a band called Boys Don't Cry.
Oh, Nick Richards, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So they do that. Nick's based in California. Have you spoken to Nick?
I had Nick on. Nick, he had some great stories.
He's a funny guy, isn't he? Yeah.
Because he told a lot of stories about the Méjean Rouge studio.
Exactly. Yes, that's right.
Yeah.
He was the owner of that really successful studio that had so many, including Duran kind of recording there.
Yeah. And then one artist that wasn't mentioned in the book was also one of my all-time favorites, was Howard Jones. And in the Running album, which was like kind of in the early 90s, And he's...
The terrible thing and the wonderful thing is that I now have to Google myself to remember who I worked with.
Right, yeah. That's funny.
I mean, largely, I think, because just I was fortunate enough to, you know, do such a large body of work over time. There are some artists that, you know, even in the book, sometimes I remember things like, oh, I should have written that in the book. Didn't I left them out.
Right.
And Howard actually is one of those. And yeah, he wouldn't thank me for that, but not because he wasn't extraordinary and I didn't love working with him, but just because, you know, the old memory is probably going a bit.
Yeah.
But thank you for reminding me. Yeah, and he's a great artist. And again, does quite a lot of those kind of rewind tours now. Yeah.
I've also had him on, and he also does like these kind of story and acoustic, you know, he'll tell a story leading into the song acoustically.
Love that. I think people love to know the backstory of things, yeah.
Right. Do you think about writing another book with all the stories that you've been told?
I think I've got a bit more living to do before, you know, it was so jam-packed full of wonderful stories you know, life seems a little bit slower in comparison to those days.
Yeah.
You know, but I would like to do perhaps an addition, you know, to add on and talk, because I love the experience of writing. But what I have written is interesting. We're talking about the backstory to things. I've written a live show with another singer friend of mine, my partner in this venture. Her name is Gina Foster. And she's had a similar career to myself as a session singer. And we've written a show. I'm just looking at the poster of it here. I'll send you. It's called Unsung Singers, The Brits Behind the Hits.
Okay.
So it's basically a live show where we sing a lot of the music that we recorded. And we tell the stories about being in the studio with Clapton and recording the pieces of work. And there's lots of humor in it, but lots of stories about the artists that we've worked with. And I absolutely love doing it. I'd love to bring it to the States.
Oh yeah, please. That'd be awesome. Or at least you record it.
Everybody out there, bring us over. Just let me know when all this madness is over. We're there.
Absolutely. But Tessa, this was great. I need to have you on again. It's so much I want to, you know, discuss with you. Everyone, go check out Backtrack. It's on Amazon. You can get the Kindle. I recommend the audiobook because it's great. She has amazing audio, you know, book voice. Thank you so much, and good luck.
My absolute pleasure, Noel. Thank you for reaching out and asking me. I'm honored.
And a special thanks to Tessa for joining me today. Go check out her book, Backtrack. It's everywhere. You can find a book. The audio version is great because she has such a great voice, like I said, in the open. Check it out. Some great stories that we didn't even touch upon during this interview. Like I said, we can talk for hours with her. If you want to follow her on Twitter, she's at Tessa Niles 1, the number 1. And if you have a guest suggestion, you can hit me up on Twitter at TheFirstNoel19 or like the page of Living My Youth on Facebook. Go to iTunes, check out all the past episodes we've had. While you're there, please rate and review the show. Don't have iTunes? Not a problem. It shows on SoundCloud. It's also on Podbean. A new episode comes out every Wednesday, sometimes Thursday, like this week. And we'll see you next week.